the fourth plenary talk of the 2020 Graph Signal Processing Workshop will be delivered by Sergio Barbarossa. Sergio is a professor at the La Sapienza University in Rome, and he's one of the European references in signal processing, with significant contributions in sensor networks, communications, and statistical signal processing. He has worked on a number of problems involving graph signals, including sampling, reconstruction, and robust graph signal processing. Today, he will talk about topological signal processing. The idea in this talk is to consider scenarios where representing the structure of the information by a graph, that is, by pairwise interactions between the variables, is not sufficient, and more general tools such as simplicial complexes and hypergraphs must be used. Thank you, Sergio, for being willing to record this talk. I hope that the audience will enjoy.
So, good morning to everyone. So, the title of this talk is Topological Signal Processing. And before starting, let me just thank the organizers who invited me to give this talk today. I'm just sorry that I cannot give the talk in public. This is actually the first time that I give a talk without looking at the eyes of people in front of me, but I hope we will all meet soon. Anyways, I just want to tell you, please do not hesitate to contact me in case you have questions, clarifications, etc. And also, I want to acknowledge the strong contribution from Stefania Sardellitti, who worked together with me along all these works here. And I also want to acknowledge the financial support by the European project 5G NIEG. So a brief summary of this talk. Well, I'm giving a talk in a workshop entitled Graph Signal Processing. I think that, of course, at the beginning, I need to motivate whether we need to go beyond graph signal processing or not. So I will try to motivate, of course, this path that I'm going to follow. And then I will start mentioning formal ways to capture multi-way relations as opposed to the pairwise relations that are typically encoded in a graph. Then I will focus on a specific topological structure, which are simplicial complexes. And I will talk about tools to analyze signals defined over a simplicial complex. Then the next topic will be learning the complex from the data. And then I will move to applications to real data. The first application will be to the biological field. I will show ways to analyze the RNA vector field. And then I will show an application to traffic data and telecommunication traffic data. Finally, I will draw some conclusion. Okay. So just at the very broad level, there will be two basic principles that guided us throughout this study. The first one is the well-known Occam's razor, saying that if we have two competing representations and we want to choose one of them, well, we should choose the sparsest one. Why? Because typically we tend to give importance to sparsity. So sparsity is a good way to extract relevant information from the data. The second point is something that I just quoted from a letter from two of the fathers of modern computer science. So in this letter, Strachey wrote to Alan Turing, "The crux of the problem of learning is recognizing relationships and being able to use them." Well, what I want to show in this presentation is mechanisms to recognizing relationships of different kinds, pairwise, multi-way relations, and so on, and being able to build sparse representations out of these topological structures. Okay. Of course, before starting, I also need to explain what do we mean by topological signal processing. Well, in a very simple way, Topological signal processing has to do with the analysis of signals defined over a topological space. What is a topological space? Is a discrete set of elements along with the definition of neighborhood relations among these elements. Okay, this is a very general way, but still it conveys the basic message. Now, just to start with some examples of signals defined over a topological space, we can have a social network where we have people, so the elements of the set would be people, but we can also group these people in subsets of different dimension. We can have subsets of dimension 2, which means pairs, but we can also have triplets and so on. Okay, what are the signals over this space? Well, we might have signals on the vertices, that is people, and these signals could capture, for example, political orientation, preferences, and so on. But we could also have signals on edges. These signals could capture, for example, how strong is the link between the two people over the edge, how many emails they exchange with each other within a week, or how many times they go out together, whatever, something that is associated to a pair. And of course, we can generalize to triplets, quadruplets, and so on. What's the goal of processing? We may want to detect clusters, we may want to predict preferences or global political orientation and its evolution over time, or we may want to recover the overall signal starting from a few samples, but where the samples are collected not only over pointwise elements, so nodes, but also over pairs, triplets, and so on. Second example, if we move to the biological field, we might have, for example, a gene expression network. Here I just collected this figure about the P53 pathway. P53 is a molecule that plays a key role in oncogenesis. And then here we have molecules and we have links among molecules, and we have also signals associated to the nodes and to the edges. So the signal on a node can represent, for example, activation. A signal on the edge can represent interaction mechanisms like attraction, repulsion, etc. What's the goal of processing? In general, in these cases, is to infer the graph topology to understand the biological mechanism. Okay, state of the art. Well, being at a workshop on graph signal processing with a well-acknowledged audience about tools used to analyze signals over graphs, I'm literally in trouble, but here I will just recall very few papers about graph signal processing. So a recent paper on the proceedings of the IEEE by Ortega and others, and then also a paper about the inference of the graph topology from data from Mateos, Segarra, Marquez, Ribeiro. And then there is also a wide literature on the so-called topological data analysis, a nearby field, essentially in computer science, where people try to extract information from data, looking at the topology of the data and extract information from the topological features. Here we will follow a different path because we will be interested on signals defined over topological space. Probably the closest work in the literature to our own work is the work by Schaub and Segarra, which also consider the analysis of signals defined over the edge set using graph signal processing tools. Okay, so trying to motivate the need to move beyond graphs. Well, from an information theoretic perspective, suppose that we have, for example, two signals, and we associate these two signals to two vertices, V1 and V3. Then we ask ourselves whether we want to draw an edge between these two elements. Clearly, we will not put an edge if these two signals are statistically independent. The presence of an edge should reflect some kind of statistical dependency between the two nodes. Okay, now what's the way, the formal way to quantify the mutual independence? We can compute, for example, the mutual information. Okay, supposing we know the joint PDF of these variables, we can compute the mutual information, which looks like this. Suppose that we have three nodes and we decided about the presence of three edges here. Now, the next step is, should we fill this triangle or not? Okay, so this is the generalization of the approach that I just described before. So how should we provide an answer to this question? We should look at the triplewise mutual information between the signals observed in B1, B2, and B3. Okay, what is the triplewise mutual information? One possible way to compute it is something like this. And so you see, again, the mutual information depends on the joint and all the marginals. Or if we want to express the mutual information in terms of entropy, we have an expression like this. From this formula, we clearly understand that if we want to take a decision about the presence of an edge, of a triangle, this decision should depend on this triplewise mutual information. But this information cannot be reduced to the set of mutual informations among the pairs at the sides of this triangle. This means that if we want to take a decision, we need to compute something that reflects this triplewise interaction among the three elements in the set. Now, if we move to a statistical topology setup, a very common framework is the one based on point clouds. So supposing we have a set of n time series or a set of n pictures, we may represent every object, either picture or time series, as a point in the point cloud. Then to extract information, we may want to relate these points to each other, for example, building a graph, or we might generalize this approach and build, for example, just for simplicity, build what is called the Vietoris-Rips complex. What is this complex? The complex is defined in this way. Given a subset of elements of any order, a simplex associated to the subset is included in the complex if each pair of points in the subset is at a distance d less than epsilon. But you see, there's no specification about the dimension of the set. So we could consider edges, triangles, tetrahedrons, and so on. So for example, suppose we do it here. We choose some epsilon, and then from this point cloud, we decide about the presence of some edges, but also some triangles, maybe some tetrahedron here. If we increase epsilon, of course, we will have more edges, more triangles, more tetrahedrons, etc. If we keep increasing, we construct different geometrical objects. Now, when we look at these objects, if we only consider edges, we could only talk in terms of connectivity, because this is what we see in a graph. We can measure connectivity, but that's all. Whereas if we include also triangles, we can also talk in terms of coverage of an area. And when we cover a area, we can extract different features, like the presence of holes, for example. I will show later on that the number of holes over a surface is indeed another important topological invariant of a set. So the question is, okay, maybe we should increase the dimension of the subsets that we are considering, because this gives us the possibility to extract additional information from the point cloud. And then the question from here is, how do we choose the epsilon, the threshold? Well, in topological data analysis, what people do is that they take all the possible values, meaningful values for epsilon. So for example, here, this is a plot drawn as a function of epsilon. And here we look at all the topological entities In particular here, these are the connected components. So at the beginning, there are many components because the graph is totally disconnected. Then as epsilon increases, the components tend to glue together. Eventually, above a certain value of epsilon, all the components will converge into a giant component that will take into account all the nodes in the graph. But this is what we can extract just looking at edges. If at the same time we consider also triangles, we can also count the number of holes. At the beginning, there's no hole, but at a certain point, we see the appearance of holes here, and maybe some of them will last more than others. Okay, so this is what people working in topological data analysis want to do. They want to extract what they call the persistent homologies. What are the persistent homologies? Are the geometrical structures that persist as a function of epsilon more than others. Why? Because they tend to associate information to the persistence of some feature. Okay, still working with this example, we can also consider the approach which is typically taken in non-parametric statistical analysis. So if from the point cloud we build a density plot, for example, using some kernel method, then again, the question is, how do we extract information from this plot without having a parametric model to work with? Well, one possibility is to take level sets. So for example, taking the lower level set of this function, we end up into a geometrical object that looks like this. And again, we can extract some topological information, like not only connectivity, but also coverage, holes, cavities in a three-dimensional domain, etc. Okay. So essentially, what we want to do is we want to analyze signals defined over a complex. And the signal can be defined over the nodes, over the edges, over the triangles, etc. And the key point here is that to capture the relation between edge signals, we need to detect triplewise relations. Essentially, this is a generalization of what we typically do in graph signal processing. Remember, with graphs here, we have a bunch of points. To each point, we associate a signal. And then from the correlation or dependence between the signals associated to different points, we take the decision on whether establish a link between these two nodes or not. Okay, so from node signals, we decide about the presence of edges. Now, if we move up of one level, if we consider signals defined over the edges, to be able to capture the relations among these signals, we need to take decisions about the triangles and so on. That's the idea. On a summary, what are the objectives of topological signal processing? Well, first, we want to find out dictionaries to represent signals. These dictionaries should incorporate the topological features of the space over which the signal is defined. And at the same time, possibly, they should give rise to sparse representations. Then, second point is to be able to infer the structure of the simplicial complex from the data. And from this structure, we want to identify invariants, which are features that are robust against deformation or possible addition of noise, etc. And one specific feature that we have in this context is that we will be able to discriminate between different signal components, like solenoidal, irrotational, harmonic components, etc. I will be, of course, more specific on this in a few slides. And we want also to have algorithms to be able to reconstruct the overall signal defined over edges or complexes of any domain from a subset of samples, just, you know, generalizing the approach which is typically followed in graph signal processing. And then there is another important addition. We want to be able to process vector fields. So fields where we associate to each point a vector, and we will see that this presents some very specific problems that we typically do not encounter with graphs. And then finally, we want to use these topological mechanisms to improve machine learning mechanisms. Okay, so after this very long introduction about the need to move to simplicial complexes or topological spaces, let me be more specific on what we mean by a simplicial complex. So the first definitions, a K-simplex, a simplex of order K, is simply an unordered set of K plus one points. So for example, a node is just one point, K is equal to zero. An edge is a pair of points, so it's a set of order one, and etc. An abstract simplicial complex is a finite collection of simplices that is closed under the operation of taking non-empty subsets. What do I mean? I mean the following. Suppose that I have a set including some triangle. Okay, if I have the triangle in the set, then all the sides of this triangle should also be included in the set. And then if I have an edge, also the endpoints of the edges, that is the endpoint nodes, should be included in the set. So this is the only defining property of a simplicial complex. So as I said, zero simplices are nodes. One simplices of order one, capture pairwise relations. Two simplices are field triangles. They capture triplewise relations, and so on. Of course, we do not necessarily have, it's not sufficient to have a click between three nodes to decide about the presence of a triangle. Here we have a triangle, here we do not. Okay. How do we represent these relations? Introducing the so-called incidence matrices, exactly as we do with graphs. The only difference is that with graphs, we stop at the incidence matrix B1, which encodes relations between edges and vertices. So even in this case, if I have a complex like this, then B1 is built in this way. So B1 is a matrix with a number of rows equal to the number of vertices and the number of columns equal to the number of edges. In each column associated to an edge, we have only two elements which are associated to the two endpoints of the edge, and the sign, minus or plus, depends on the arrow that we have on the orientation that we have on the edge. Okay, let's move further. Now, if we consider triangles, we need to introduce the incidence matrix B2, which has a number of columns equal to the number of triangles, and the number of rows is the number of edges here. Again, for every triangle, which means column, now we have three elements, the three edges of the triangle, and the sign of each element here depends again on the orientation of the edges versus the orientation of the triangle. Please know that even when we increase the orientation, the dimension of the subset, when we move to triangles, tetrahedrons, etc., there are only two possible choices for the orientation. So the number of orientation does not increase with the dimension of the set. Okay, once we have the incidence matrices, we can build the Laplacian matrices in this way. And the interesting fact that we can observe here, so L0 is well known. The interesting point is that if we look at L1, L2, etc., up to the upper level, minus one, we can see that all the higher order Laplacian matrices just contain two terms. Why two? Because, for example, L1, which is the edge Laplacian and establishes the relations between edges. Now, when we talk about two edges, can be neighbors to each other in two different ways. They can be lower adjacent if they share a common vertex, or they can be upper adjacent if they are faces of the same triangle. And just because we always have these two possibilities, this is exactly why in the Laplacian we have these two terms. One captures the lower adjacency, the other one captures the upper adjacency. Okay. Now, the first important features that we can extract from the Laplacian matrices are the so-called Betti numbers. What are the Betti numbers? They are defined as the nullity of the high-order Laplacian matrices. So, for example, beta 0 is the nullity, so the dimension of the null space of L0. Well, this number is equal to the number of connected components, as well known to everyone working with graphs. Now, if we move one layer up, if we take the dimension of the null space of L1, this is beta 1, and beta 1 counts the number of holes. If we go up again, if we take the nullity of L2, this is beta 2, and this captures the number of cavities in the three-dimensional space. So these are invariants, and these are robust features that extract some important information, for example, in a point cloud. Now, having defined the structure, the domain over which the signal is defined, let's move to the signal. What is a signal over a simplicial complex? It's essentially a mapping from the simplicial complex to the real number, okay? But now we might have signals of different order. For us, the order of a signal is equal to the order of the complex over which the signal is defined. So for example, signals over the nodes are signals of order zero. Signals over the edges are signals of order one, etc. We might have several examples. And as I mentioned before, I will not go into this again, but for example, in a co-authorship network, we might have a signal associated to a set of people, and to measure, this signal could measure, for example, the number of papers that the people in the set co-author with each other. Now, what is the first goal of signal processing over a simplicial complex? Would be to find a sparse representation that captures the topological properties of the domain over which the signal is defined. And we will see that when we look for the basis for these signals, the structure of the basis can be completely different as we move from one level to the other, from one order to the other. But the interesting point is that we will see that there is a nice interplay between signals of different orders. Now, so let's go to the question of how to build a dictionary for signals defined over complexes of different order. Let's start, as in graph signal processing, with the complex of zero order, so a graph. So now in a graph, we want to start from a function that represents some topological feature of the graph. One important function is the cut size. So what is the cut size? It is computed in this way. Given a collection of points, given a graph, essentially, we partition the graph into sets, and then we count the number of edges going from one set to the other. Okay, then if we consider all possible partitions, and then we take the minimum of the cut size, this is the well-known minimum cut. Now, knowing the minimum cut, we might formulate our problem in this way. We want to find a unitary basis that minimizes the cut size, okay? Now, at this point, this problem still is not very well formulated. Why? Because when we look for unitary basis, we want vectors defined over a real domain, but here we start from a function which is defined over sets, not the cut size. How can we deal with this? Okay, we can do what is called the real extension of the set function, And one possibility is to resort to the so-called Lovash extension. So, for example, with graphs, if we consider a directed graph and we consider the Lovash extension of the cut size, we end up into something that assumes this form here, where Aij is the usual adjacency coefficient in the graph. If we consider an undirected graph, for simplicity, the Lovash extension of the cut size is this, and you can recognize that this function corresponds to the L1 norm total variation of a real valued signal over a graph. So we see, we start from a function, the cut size, we compute its real extension through Lovash theory, we end up with a real valued function that assumes also a well-known form, it's the total variation. Now, so if we want to build a basis, we can formulate the problem in this way. We say we want to build a basis of orthonormal vectors as the solution of this problem here. We want to minimize the sum of the total variations for every vector in the basis, subject to a unitary constraint, and maybe a constraint on the first eigenvector, which assumes a known form in graph theory. Okay, what's the problem here? Well, the objective function is convex, but unfortunately the unitary constraint makes the problem non-convex. But if we relax the problem just a little bit, instead of using the L1 norm total variation, we use the L2 norm, we end up into this problem here. And even though also this problem, of course, is non-convex, nevertheless, its solution is well known. We want to minimize a quadratic form built on L under a unitary constraint where the solution is given by the eigenvectors of L0. So this approach says that to analyze signals defined over the vertices of the graph, we should take the eigenvectors of L0. And indeed, this is the basic point giving rise to spectral graph theory, to the clustering algorithms, and so on. Okay, now let's move on. Let's consider now a simplicial complex of order 1 where we also have triangles. Okay, and now we want to find a basis to analyze signals defined over edges. So what do? We generalize. Instead of the cut size, we define a cut defined over a partition over 3 sets. Okay, so given a partition on 3 sets of the overall complex, we count the number of triangles, filled triangles, that glue these 3 sets together. Okay, we call this the cut size of order 1. So again, as before, we want to find a unit basis for edge signals that minimizes this first order cut function. How do we proceed? As before, we use Lovash extension, we compute a real valued function defined over a real domain of dimension equal to the number of edges. And the interesting point is that when you look at this function, we see that what appears here is the incidence matrix B2, which, if you remember, captures the relation between edges and triangles. Again, exactly as before, if we relax the objective function and we use an L2 norm here, this function can be written as a quadratic form built on this matrix here. So again, if we want to find a unitary basis minimizing this objective function subject to the unitary constraint, we end up with the eigenvectors of this function here, B2, B2 transpose, okay? Okay, so at this point, the procedure is clear. We should take all the Laplacian matrices of different orders. Of course, the order will depend on the order of the signals that we want to analyze. If we only have edge signals, we end up onto the L1 order. If we have signals defined over triplets, we can increase the order. But the point is that according to the theory that I explained before, every time we should take the eigen decomposition of the high order Laplacian matrix and the basis for our signals should be given by the eigenvectors of this higher-order Laplacian matrix. Now, the interesting point is that when we look at these eigenvectors, they have very interesting properties. For example, if you look, for example, at the edge Laplacian, you see here we have a matrix given by the sum of two different matrices. And typically, the eigenvectors of the sum, of course, is not simply related to the eigenvectors of each component. Nevertheless, in this case, this is actually the case. It can be proved, this is known, it can be proved very easily, that the eigenvectors associated to the non-null eigenvalues of Lk are either the eigenvectors of the first part or the eigenvectors of the second part. And the same happens for the eigenvalues. And this is a very interesting property. The other point is that if we know the eigenvectors, for example, of this part here, then we immediately know the eigenvectors of the other matrix here, even though, you know, they are not the same, of course, and they are not even the transpose of each other. But it's very simple to prove that if we know the eigenvector of this matrix, and this is B, well, the eigenvectors of this other matrix here is simply given by BK transpose B. So every time, if we know these eigenvectors, we immediately know these ones. So we only need to compute these ones. And then we can proceed iteratively. Okay. Now, just to give a pictorial example, I start with graphs. So if I have a modular graph composed of three clusters, and I take the eigenvector associated to the second smallest eigenvalue of the graph, as well known, we will have an eigenvector like this. The eigenvector is encoded by the colors in each cluster. And then you can see that the eigenvector is almost constant or very smooth within each cluster, even though it can assume arbitrary values across different clusters. So this is one eigenvector defined over the nodes. If we move one level up and we take the eigenvectors of B1 transpose B1, this is a vector defined over the edges of the graph. So you should look at the edges. When you look at the signal over the edges, white signal means very low, black signal means very high. So it's interesting to see that the eigenvector associated to this, the first eigenvector associated to this matrix here has high components in the intercluster edges, whereas it's almost zero within each cluster. And actually, this eigenvector can be shown formally. It's actually the gradient of the eigenvector defined over the nodes that we have seen before. Now, in a more general terms, what these properties of the eigenvectors bring into our field is what is called the Hodge decomposition, that says that at every level, I will focus on the edge level, but this can be stated for any for every level k. So, but at the edge level, the real space of dimension e, the number of edges, can always be decomposed into the direct sum of three components. A component given by the vectors lying in the image of B1 transpose, plus the vectors lying in the image of B2, plus the vectors lying in the kernel of L1, which coincides with the intersection between the kernel of B1 and the kernel of B2 transposed. And I remind you, I mentioned it before, the dimension of the kernel, the node space of L1 or Lk in general, represents a topological invariant because it quantifies the number of connected components, number of holes, number of cavities, if we consider order 1, 0, 1, 2, etc. Now, what does it mean in terms of signal processing? It means that every signal defined over the edges can always be decomposed into three orthogonal components, which are an irrotational component, S1, that can be represented in this way. This signal has a curve, zero curl, which means that if we consider all the triangles, if we take the flow sum along every triangle, this flow sum will be zero. So this is what we call the irrotational component. Then we have a solenoidal component, S1 sol, which can be written in this way as a function of a signal of order 2. This function here represents the solenoidal component. What is this? This is associated to divergence. It is a divergence-free component, and it's a signal such that for each node, there will be the inflow on the node will be exactly equal to the outflow on the node. And finally, SH is the harmonic component. But it's interesting to see that signals of order 1 can be associated, at least some of their component, is directly related to signals of order 0 or to signals of order 2. Now, of course, we want to have some kind of physical intuition about what these components are. Well, the intuition is this. If we make a conceptual link with the analog counterpart of this theory, well, essentially we can see the following, that when we multiply a vector defined over the nodes by B1 transpose, we are taking the gradient of the vector. When we multiply a signal defined over the edges by B1, we are taking the divergence. And divergence is the net flow on the node. So the difference between inflow and outflow. When we multiply an edge signal by B2 transpose, we are taking the curl of the signal along a triangle. When we build L0, this is the well-known Laplacian operator, so minus the divergence of the gradient. When we take L1, this is the so-called Helmholtzian operator, and this is well-known in, for example, in electromagnetic theory. When if you have an electromagnetic field defined over the usual, the conventional three-dimensional domain, we know very well that a vector field can always be decomposed into the sum of the gradient of a scalar potential plus the curl of a vector potential. And this will be exactly the first two components. And then usually this is what we read from physics books on electromagnetic theory. Here we can also have the harmonic field. Why don't we have the harmonic component in the continuous space? But just because in continuous space, at least the space we are used to, there are no holes, no cavities. And for this reason, the dimension of the kernel is zero, and this is exactly why we don't have the harmonic component. Okay, now that we have these tools, what do we do with them? Well, for example, we can filter edge signals. So for example, let me start with a simulated problem. Suppose we have a network, and here we have nodes, and we simulated the traffic data, random traffic data among these points. And then we added two nodes that are sending a lot of jam, a lot of spam across the network. And the problem is to detect the spamming nodes. Okay, so the spamming means some flow that is coming out of some edges. Okay, it means that there will be some edges that evidently do not have a good equilibrium because between what comes in and what goes out. So how can we detect these spamming nodes? Okay, in terms of the theory I just explained, we take the observed signal S1 and we project the signal into a space orthogonal to the solenoidal component. Okay, so we use these eigenvectors here, which are the eigenvectors associated to the non-null eigenvalues of B2 transpose. And you can see the result. You see the result, and you know the signal is defined over the edges. And again, white means low signal, black means large signal. So you can clearly see from here that from the projection from here to there, we can clearly see that there are two nodes around which the signal over the edges is much higher than in the other. So this clearly identifies the two jamming nodes. Okay, this is the first, very simple, but I think it's interesting, the first interesting application of this theory. Now, second issue we want to cover is the inference of the topology, of the simplicial complex topology from data. So let's consider edge signals. We want to infer the structure of L1. And of course, just because we are talking about edge signal, this means that the signals are defined over edges, which implies that the edges are known. So L0 is known, which means B1 is known. So the first part of L1 is known. This means that we need to estimate the second part. Good. Now, if you want to recover this part, first of all, we need to ask ourselves, do we really need to build this part or not? Well, the answer depends on the data. So what we do is this. From the data, we project the data into a subspace orthogonal to the irrotational component. Okay, so if the signal that we get, which represents the solenoidal component, is very low, it means that actually there is no need to estimate this component. So we just stop there. We do not put any triangle. On the contrary, if we realize that this signal here has some norm greater than some threshold, it means that it makes sense. We should detect triangles from the data, which means we need to identify the columns of the matrix B2. Okay, how do we do it? We propose two algorithms. The first one called the minimum total variation algorithm, where we want to find the columns of B2 as the solution of the following problem, where we want to minimize, if you recall it, this is the total variation of the signal over the simplicial complex, and Tn are the coefficients associated to each possible triangle in the graph. So to each click, we associate a binary value, which can be either 0 or 1, and we want to find out Tn. We impose an L0 constraint, which means the number of triangles, into the problem. And even though this problem is clearly non-convex, its solution can be found in closed form. So it's very simple algorithm to run. Of course, the critical issue here is how to estimate T, the number of triangles, which of course we do not know a priori. So we run the algorithm over different data sets to estimate the best choice for T, the number of triangles in the data set. And then the other, the alternative technique is a technique where we want to minimize, where we want to find at the same time the triangles, the triangle coefficients, T, as before, and at the same time we want to find out the coefficients of the representation of X over a given basis. So starting from X, we look for S, and again imposing a constraint on the L0 norm of T. And here in G is a regularization term that takes into account the total variation of these signals over the complex. Okay, this is just three examples of simulated data. This is the original simplex, and this is the recovered simplex, which is not pretty similar. But of course, this is, let's say, under control because it's simulated data. We also run simulations over a lot of data just to understand how the algorithm will behave. And essentially what we see is that if the percentage of filled triangles increases, then the algorithm, the inference algorithm, can perform pretty well. Whereas when the percentage of triangles is very low, then the detection rate can be much lower. Why is this? This happens because when the number of triangles is very low, it means that L1 has a very big kernel. And when the kernel is very big, we have a problem because we know very well that there's no unique way to identify a basis for the kernel of a matrix. This lack of uniqueness is what causes this higher error here. Okay, but now let's move to the application to real data. So the first application is the analysis of traffic data, telecommunication traffic data. So the question is this: do we really need to move from graphs to simplicial complexes? So to answer, we formulate the problem in this way. We have L1. L1 contains two terms, L1 down or up. L1 down depends only on B1, L1 up depends on B2. Now, when choosing the dictionary to analyze the traffic data, the question is, should we use the eigenvectors of L1 down, or should we use the eigenvectors of L1, including B2, B2 transpose? Okay, so we said, okay, let's build the two dictionaries, U1 and U1 minus, associated to the two different matrices. And then we say, okay, the test is the following. Given the data, we want to find its sparsest representation S1 as a solution of this problem here. We want to minimize the L1 norm of S1 subject to a fitting constraint. You know, we want to fit the observed data with S1 using as a dictionary either U1 or U1 minus. Okay. In both cases, since typically we are dealing only with a limited observation of the network, we cannot observe all the edges at the given time. We only observe samples from this traffic data. In both cases, we use the optimal reconstruction of the entire signal from the samples using the model that we are building here. Okay, then these are the data. This is the city of Milan. And in this plot, we have the color represents the amount of traffic in the area. And then we have traffic data measuring the number of wireless calls between two different pairs of the points in the city as a function of time. Okay, so when we applied our algorithm, this is the result. So here we have a plot showing sparsity versus the minimum square error for the two algorithms. The one including all the components for L1, and the other one including only L1 down. And from here we can clearly see that there is a big advantage. You know, for a given sparsity, we can have a much, much smaller mean square error. Here, or the reverse. For a given mean square error, we can have a much sparser representation, which is what we are looking for. At the same time, if we consider what happens as a function of the number of samples that we collect, we can again see a big advantage in terms of reconstruction error between the two methods. This means that evidently from the real data, it makes sense to infer the structure of triangles associated to the edge signals, because this structure helps us to reduce the reconstruction error. Now, the other application is an application of a vector field. In particular, the case that we analyzed here, thanks to the collaboration to some colleagues from medicine school, is the following. People in biology very recently started analyzing the so-called RNA velocity. The RNA is the ribonucleic acid, and in a single cell. So in a single cell, what I'm able to do is to estimate how the concentration of the RNA changes over time, depending on what's going on in the cell. And from this information, the biologists are able to capture how the cell is changing its behavior. This change could be physiological or could be pathological, so it needs to be kept under control. Now, of course, just because this analysis is taken on a single cell basis, of course we can have a lot of error in the estimation of these velocity vectors. So what we propose is the following. We said, okay, given the velocity field, we want to filter the field to possibly reduce the effect of noise, and at the same time possibly being able to capture some behavior, as I will show in a few moments. So what is a vector field? A vector field is a set of vectors associated to a set of points. So at this point, there's no simplicial complex. We only have points, and for each point, we have a vector. Okay, we want to filter this vector. What is the approach? Okay, the approach is the following: is a three-step approach. First of all, we map the vector field onto a simplicial complex. So we build a simplicial complex, and we put edges here, just making a very simple Delaunay triangulation here. Okay, then we map each vector onto the edges of this simplicial complex. Okay, so from one vector over a point, we end up into scalar values over the edges of this complex. Once we have the edge signal defined over the edges, we filter the flow, the edge signal. And then finally, we map this flow signal back to a vector field. I will show it with an example. So in the first example, we filter the flow signal in this way. We want to give an X1. We want to find the S1 that minimizes the following part, which is it's a square norm plus a total variation plus an L1 norm, just to enforce sparsity of S1. Okay, so we do it on S1, the signal defined over the edges, and then we map the signal back onto the vector field. And this is the result, you see? And this is a very smooth behavior that we can observe here. Or just because we have these tools, we also may want to emphasize some components as opposed to another. For example, we can filter the flow signal just projecting onto the irrotational component. So here we want to emphasize the irrotational component, and this is what happens, you see? So this is something where we have signals going in this direction and signals here. And if you think of the usual processing where we may take, let's say, some kind of average consensus, well, the average consensus over the vectors in some cases can work pretty bad. Why? Because, for example, if we have an exact signal irradiating from one point, when we take the average, the local average can also go to zero and destroy completely this kind of signals. Whereas when we take this irrotational component, we can actually emphasize this behavior. Or conversely, we can also project the signal onto the solenoidal component. And so you see, here we can clearly see that there is a solenoidal component, which is more evident than before. Okay, this is the end of the talk. So I hope I motivated the extension of graph signal processing tools to higher order complexes. Of course, there is a lot to do, especially in the analysis of real data of higher order dimension. And one important application would be the application of these topological tools to deep learning, generalizing what is now known as geometric deep learning to what could be called topological deep learning. That's the conclusion of my talk. Thanks a lot for listening. For any question, please do not hesitate to contact me at my email. All the best. I hope to see you soon in person. Bye-bye.